Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for joining us today. I'm very excited for today's event here and our guest. He and I have been talking about trying to get him on this platform for quite some time, and we're trying to work out basically the most useful topic of content to present to the group. So I'm very much appreciative of him taking the time to join us today. Dr. Rigved Tadwalkar is a consultative cardiologist with the Pacific Heart Institute. He is a fellow of the American College of Cardiology and the American College of Physicians, and is board certified in cardiovascular disease, echocardiography, cardiovascular CT, nuclear cardiology, and internal medicine. He went to the University of Southern California for his undergraduate studies, and then went on to George Washington University for his medical degree. He then proceeded to complete his internship and residency in internal medicine at Cedars-Sinai and at the West LA VA Hospital. He then went on to pursue his fellowship in cardiovascular disease at the UCLA Medical Center, which resulted in several awards, including the Excellence in Cardiology Fellowship Award for cardiovascular research. And he served as the chief cardiology fellow near the end of his fellowship, which involved managing the day-to-day operations of the fellows of the programs, including education and clinical activities. And that's a big part of why I wanted to talk to him today. He's becoming, and I've been able to watch it and very excited to follow along with him, an emerging voice in the field, where he's contributed to or featured by a variety of local leading media outlets, including ABC, US News and World Reports, LA Times, and others. He serves on the Forbes Health Advisory Board and the Medical Review Board of Prevention Magazine, a multi-time Super Doctor Rising Star winner. He's also on the top doctor list for Los Angeles Magazine. He has a strong interest and not only improving the cardiovascular health of his patients, but the general population. And as we build this era of neuroscience, it's becoming more and more clear how interconnected these two organ systems are. And I couldn't think of a better speaker to chat with us today about this than Dr. Tadwalkar. Rigved, with that, the floor is yours. Thank you so much.
Yeah, Wally, thank you so much for the fantastic introduction. Definitely pumped me up, to another level there. So I really appreciate it. But thank you so much for having me. It is something we've been trying to coordinate, and trying to find a topic of interest has been a little challenging because there are a lot of areas where cardiovascular medicine and neurologic health overlap. And in some places, it's fairly a small area. But what I wanted to do is just go macro level, as macro as we can, without getting too off base. And hopefully, everyone finds this to be quite appealing, because we're going to look at things from a big picture perspective, and it should relate to a lot of different facets of medicine. So let me just make sure I can. There we go. Okay. So disclosures, I have none that are relevant to this specific talk. So obviously, whenever you see these presentations, you always get a slide on epidemiology. I don't want to spend too much time on it. Everyone sort of knows this, but cardiovascular disease is the leading cause of death globally, if that was not already known. So 17.9 million deaths in 2019, according to the WHO, and about one in four deaths in the United States. But neurologic disease is also a leading cause of morbidity and mortality. And in 2019, there was 9.4 million deaths globally from neurologic disease, with stroke being a leading cause of death worldwide, about 5.5 million deaths globally. So what's the relationship? So the relationship is that cardiovascular and neurologic conditions are related, and many cardiovascular risk factors increase the risk of neurologic conditions. So specifically, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, diabetes would be the top ones that increase the risk of cardiovascular disease and neurologic decline, typically through damage to blood vessels. So that's going to be a central topic for this initial part of the talk. And cardiovascular disease can directly impact brain function. So a common example are mini strokes, for example, which can damage brain tissue, leading to cognitive impairment and vascular dementia. Another important facet of the relationship is inflammation and oxidative stress, in that chronic inflammation can increase the risk of cardiovascular disease and conditions that are neurodegenerative, such as Alzheimer's disease. But I do want to underscore that the relationship is complex and multifactorial. Some risk factors are shared, others may be specific to one condition or the other. So we just briefly touched on this, but essentially risk factors that you all probably know of, just practicing medicine. So we talked about the big three: blood pressure, cholesterol, diabetes, certainly tobacco use, obesity, and physical inactivity, because both of those things can lend to the others, specifically the big three, as can poor diet. Sleep apnea is an emerging risk factor, one that is probably a diagnosis that's probably not thought of too often when we think of cardiovascular disease risk. And it is something that we should be screening for increasingly, as literature over the past 5 to 10 years has shown the increasing relationship between sleep apnea and cardiovascular and neurovascular disease. So what are the mechanisms? How do each of these conditions contribute? So the main one is reduced blood flow and oxygen supply. So vascular disease, as we know, can narrow or block blood vessels. Then we have this concept of microinfarctions, which a lot of neurocentric individuals or physicians are aware of. So small strokes can lead to small areas of brain damage, which can accumulate over time in a stepwise manner. We also have inflammation, which includes the release of cytokines and other substances that can damage blood vessels directly, as well as brain cells. And of course, atherosclerosis, which can contribute to each of these processes through the deposition of fatty deposits in the walls of the arteries. What else? So homocysteine is one of those that has probably been discussed in more depth in prior years, but it's still an important mechanistic association. It's an amino acid associated with an increased risk of CV disease, stroke, and dementia. Unfortunately, clinical trials and studies that have looked at lowering homocysteine have not really panned out in terms of providing the type of protection we had hoped. Also, blood-brain barrier dysfunction. So with these risk factors, we have disruption of the integrity of the blood-brain barrier, allowing for more permeability, more immune cells, toxin, metabolic waste products, et cetera, which can contribute to neurologic disease. Genetic factors, of course, this crowd probably knows more so than myself. APOE4 gene association with Alzheimer's risk is a great example of a genetic factor. And then I don't want to forget about the gut microbiome, which notably and appropriately has been receiving attention more recently as inflammation related to the gut, alterations in metabolism, leaky gut, TMAO, there's a whole number of different substances, metabolites that can contribute to poor cardiovascular and neurologic health. Some people feel that the vagus nerve is the central mechanism behind how the organ systems are all related when it comes to this. So types of cognitive impairment associated with cardiovascular disease, again, probably more your realm than it is mine, but it includes things like mild cognitive impairment, which I would guess is a lot more prevalent than we would expect because these deficits don't impair daily function. But of course, involves vascular dementia and Alzheimer's disease, which are, you know, leading issues. Cognitive decline, generalized deterioration of cognition in multiple domains, obviously we'll see this, and then even a decline in executive functioning as well. So what are some landmark studies in cardiovascular and neurologic health? There is a lot, and so it was hard to summarize all of them. So I looked at some of the big studies, and of course, a conversation about this is not complete without discussing Framingham, looking at the large Framingham study from the 1940s onwards that has been ongoing, looking at a community in Connecticut, basically 14,000 plus patients, which really was the first study or collection of studies, I should say, that really looked at how risk factors like hypertension, hyperlipidemia, tobacco had led to cardiovascular disease and even increased cognitive decline as well. Then moving into the late 1980s, we saw a number of other studies like the cardiovascular health study. I put in bold some of the important associations that were new from these studies, but they all generally say the same thing, which is that we see these associations between risk factors and cardiovascular and neurologic disease. With the CHS study, we saw that association with homocysteine and possible CV disease and neurologic disease. With the ARIC study, we saw that midlife hypertension led to increased cognitive decline and dementia later in life. We saw those who were in a higher education group had less cognitive decline. There was the NOMA study, also known as the Northern Manhattan study. This was notable because it was a quote unquote urban population. So in New York, we saw that these risk factors were similarly driving events and issues, and so on and so forth. The WHIMS study, I think it's the Women's Health Initiative MIND study, if I'm not mistaken, or memory study, I believe, which looked at 10,000 or so postmenopausal women and showed that hormone replacement, estrogen and progesterone and estrogen, didn't really help in terms of neurologic function. And as you can see in that little box, you know, increased cognitive decline and dementia with dual therapy, and no protective effect on cognition, and maybe increased stroke with estrogen alone. A few more, and I'll try to get through these relatively briefly, just not to, to bore you too much, but just some other names that you should know of. I think among this list, the MESA study really pops out, especially for us in the cardiology community. This is a study that has over 7,000 multi-ethnic patients from the United States and elsewhere, I believe, and has spawned a number of studies looking at associations between coronary calcium, other CV risk factors, and disease states. From a neurologic perspective, this includes white matter hyperintensities, cerebral infarcts, cerebral microbleeds, cognitive decline, dementia. All of this is associated with cardiovascular risk factors. The UK Biobank also is one to be to make note of, just because of the size and diversity of its participants, over 500,000 individuals. What makes this one special is that it does incorporate genetic and environmental data and helps us tease out how those factors play into things in making disease associations. So there probably isn't a week or two that goes by that we don't see a study that is based on the UK Biobank. And then, of course, we'd want to talk about the SPRINT trial, which was a landmark trial in the cardiology community in 2015, looking at intensive versus standard treatment of blood pressure and how that affected cardiovascular outcomes in a positive way. But a sub-study of this, the SPRINT MIND trial in 2019, showed that intensive treatment led to a lower risk of mild cognitive impairment or mild cognitive impairment and probable dementia. Interestingly enough, it didn't show that association for probable dementia alone, which may be just a result of statistical methods, but it did also show a lower incidence of white matter lesions, sort of further supporting this, that, you know, good blood pressure control is important for these issues. So moving forward, so essentially, the next question or the next situation is, okay, so we know about these methods, we know about the association, we know about the mechanisms. What are some things that we can do to modify risk? So this is not particularly cognitively challenging for us as physicians. These are all things we talk about often. Sometimes we don't talk about it in a formalized way, which is why we're discussing it now. But there's this beautiful document from the American Heart Association within the past year or two. I want to say within the past year, it's called Life's Essential Eight, which is a reiteration of, or an iteration, I should say, of Life Simple Seven, which looked at initially at seven characteristics that can modify cardiovascular risk. And then an eighth one was added on, which was sleep, which is mentioned there right at the end. But essentially, without belaboring this point, some things that should be noted just to kind of formalize this discussion, especially when you're having it with patients, which is that from a dietary perspective, the focus really should be vegetables, fruits, whole grains, plant-based protein, lean animal protein. From a physical activity perspective, the key recommendation is 150 minutes per week of moderate intensity activity. So if you break that down, that's actually just 30 minutes 5 days a week. So it's really actually not all that intensive, and even brisk walking counts. So this is a very easy and motivational way to get people to exercise if they're otherwise physically inactive. The idea with physical activity is to gradually increase weight bearing and intensity. And in fact, in a study over the past year, I think it was in the European Heart Journal, we saw that weight bearing exercise specifically has independent cardiovascular benefit over just usual quote unquote cardio exercise. Smoking cessation obviously is important. The current paradigm is set a quit date, choose a method, decide what you need, whether it's medical interventions or some sort of tobacco replacement, and then prepare and then ultimately quit. And then sleep is the new one. But basically, the focus in the most recent document is really quantity of sleep. We know that there are other metrics like quality of sleep, et cetera, but quantity of sleep, and specifically focusing at about 8 hours, that's where we see the optimal amount of sleep, or 7 to 9, I guess, if you look at a range, no less, no more, actually, because we do see increased cardiovascular risk on either side of that. But what was interesting in the document is that they made a lot of reference to modern day issues like devices. So they talk about keeping your device away from the bed, dimming the device if you are going to utilize it before you sleep, blocking specific apps, especially if you're scrolling a lot and spending a lot of time on your phone, and of course, setting an alarm in the morning. But I thought it was interesting that, you know, we need to talk about this now because a lot of people waste time on their phone before they sleep, and then they're taking away precious sleeping hours. On this slide, I talked about how each of these issues can sort of, or how each of these particular interventions can improve vascular health. And so you can read that at your own time as well. Obviously, other lifestyle factors, managing weight, controlling cholesterol, blood sugar, and blood pressure, which we discussed. I think the key thing to mention here for most people and to sort of stress to patients is like, keep it as simple as possible. When we talk about weight, talk about calories in versus calories out. I realize it's very simplistic and it may not be suitable enough for many patients, but if you can sort of discuss how eating well, controlling portions, being active, and how that sort of plugs into the equation when it comes to managing weight, then that can certainly be helpful. When we talk about cholesterol, try to, you know, talk about the good versus bad. We know in reality, there's actually a lot more to the story. Not all HDLs are good, for example. There may be atherogenic HDLs as well. But just to keep it simple and to kind of stress the point, you know, we can sort of discuss that there are good and bad cholesterols. But specifically in today's era, I tend to have people focus just on their LDL cholesterol, since that seems to be the most clinically actionable. And then, of course, you know, the other things you can see here, like tracking blood pressure and managing blood sugar. So interventions to improve brain health. So again, a little bit less of my realm, but things that I thought I should include. Cognitive training, of course, is important. This includes memory training exercises, problem solving games, aerobic exercise, of course, to improve blood flow, promote growth of new neurons, improve brain plasticity. And then meditation, which has become a focus because it can help focus the mind on a particular object to achieve mental clarity and relaxation. And we think that this, beyond just reducing stress, can help regulate the HPA axis and influence the release of neurotransmitters as well. What else? So nutritional interventions are important as well. And while in the cardiology community, we're still a little stiff about supplements, I have noticed that in the neurology community that, you know, there's a little bit more leeway and there may be some more evidence behind using some of these nutritional interventions, including omega-3s and vitamins for antioxidant benefits. Of course, fruits, vegetables, tea. I would actually put coffee on the list as well for their polyphenols, which can have a variety of different effects that it can be positive. And generally speaking, we've been very good about, I would say, I tell people coffee is sort of like the saving grace because it's like the one vice, quote unquote, that people could have that is generally good for them as long as they're not abusing it and having more than a couple cups, 2 to 3 cups per day. And then you can see some of the other nutritional interventions that have been shown to be helpful for brain health. And of course, social engagement is a big one for reduced stress, neurotransmitter regulation, cognitive stimulation. All of these things we think are actually quite helpful. Things that you may also know more about than myself, but transcranial magnetic stimulation, this is the use of magnetic fields to generate electrical currents in regions of the brain, has been found in some situations to be helpful in stroke recovery, for example, with motor function. And then there is similar but sort of different transcranial direct current stimulation, which uses weak electrical currents to the scalp using electrodes, which may be helpful in certain neurodegenerative states as well. And perhaps you may have more information about this than I would, but there are just some additional adjunctive interventions that might improve things for specific neurologic disease states. So I want to shift the discussion for a moment, we're right at about 20 minutes, to talk about medical and procedural interventions for risk factor modification. And specifically, I want to talk about blood pressure and cholesterol. And even though those things might sound quite foundational, we may think that, hey, we have a lot of things figured out, which we do, there is still a lot on the horizon. So I want to discuss that. So focusing in on hypertension specifically, there's a few things that you should know about. And we'll start with the most basic, which includes combination therapy, but we'll move into novel agents, some procedural approaches, and how Pacific Heart is involved with that as well, and then discuss personalized treatment. So I do want to spend a little bit of time talking about pharmacogenomics as well. So combination therapy is important. A lot of times when we treat blood pressure, we often stick with a single agent, but we have increasing evidence that combination therapy is recognized as an effective blood pressure lowering strategy over monotherapy and can be helpful because we're targeting multiple mechanisms at once. So if you're treating blood pressure, it doesn't hurt, especially if they're over the 140 systolic, to do a two-drug approach or at least try an initial therapy at an intermediate dose. And if not really working as well as anticipated, adding on a second agent at a low dose, because we find that is often more efficacious than maxing out the first medication. Obviously, a focus of the guidelines recently, because there's so many classes of blood pressure drugs, has been an individualized approach. And what that means is that instead of choosing a specific agent as the initial monotherapy, as the medicine of choice, even though we have those being calcium channel blockers and ARBs or ACEs, if there are other comorbidities, we want to target those. So a choice of an antihypertensive should be based on individual patient characteristics. For example, if someone has hypertension but has also been found to have newly diagnosed heart failure, you know, we may be more inclined to get them on a beta blocker first, you know, to achieve their goal-directed medical therapy. But essentially, the idea is that we want this individualized approach based on comorbidity so that medications can be combined to provide desired effects beyond just blood pressure lowering. We want to actually help improve their cardiovascular condition as well. And then more recently, fixed dose or poly pill formulations have gained popularity. I have to admit that as cardiologists, we haven't really been all that great about promoting these. We are still really apt to use single agents and then kind of titrate them separately. Part of that is, I think, so we have more control over how we use the medications, but in clinical trial data, fixed dose combinations seem to improve medication adherence and therefore improve blood pressure. Just a few recent clinical trials, I won't belabor these too much, but basically showing how combination therapies can improve med-adherence and parameters, including blood pressure. In the ACCOMPLISH trial in 2015, the one there at the bottom, looking at resistant hypertension patients, we see that combination therapy utilizing an MRA, spironolactone specifically, to be effective. And this is sort of where some of the dogma comes in about using spironolactone as a fourth line agent for resistant hypertension. And we'll get into some stuff surrounding this in a moment. So what are some novel drugs? Well, the truth is that many of the drugs that we use that are novel are really aimed at other disease processes, but happen to lower blood pressure as well. And in time, we will find if they are helpful in of themselves to just be a suitable blood pressure lowering agents. So there is still, you know, more coming down the pipeline regarding that, but I thought I would talk about some, I guess, relatively novel or newer drugs that we are using for other conditions for the heart that can lead to blood pressure lowering. Just to give people an overview so that when they see this, you know, they have an idea of what these medicines are. So the first one I'd like to talk about is Entresto, also known as sacubitril valsartan, which is an angiotensin receptor neprilysin inhibitor. It's kind of a mouthful. We call them ARNIs, A-R-N-Is. And what they do is that they block the action of angiotensin II and inhibit the breakdown of peptides that promote vasodilation. So that's what the sacubitril component does. And you can see on the schematic there for the bottom portion of the panel, how sacubitril functions to cause vasodilation, lower blood pressure, reduce sympathetic tone, aldosterone, and actually have this beneficial effect of natriuresis and diuresis. This is helpful in the heart failure population. And in fact, Entresto was validated in a large scale clinical trial called Paradigm that showed that use of the medication in the heart failure population with reduced ejection fraction led to reduced hospitalization and cardiovascular death than the comparator, which was an ACE inhibitor. And there have been a number of other studies looking at Entresto for other populations, including heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Of course, we'd want to talk about SGLT2 inhibitors. Many of you are probably already using these for a variety of reasons. Initially, were pitched as diabetic agents because of the way they work on the sodium glucose cotransporter in the proximal convoluted tubule. Will lead to increased sodium and glucose excretion. But as a result of that, we saw a lot of off-target effects as well. From a cardiovascular perspective, reduced plasma volume and improved endothelial function, and a reduction in ventricular preload, which have made the agents particularly effective in not only heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, but also heart failure with preserved ejection fraction as well. We have found that the medications are quite helpful in the chronic kidney disease population as well, in addition to improving glycemic control. So I would say that by and large, these are probably the statins of our era, in the sense that we see these multi-pleiotropic sorts of effects that can be quite helpful in terms of metabolic health with the SGLT2 inhibitors. And to not stray too far from the theme, they can also contribute to additional modest lowering in blood pressure, at least of a few points. So sometimes can be helpful in that regard as well. Vericiguat is another one I want to talk about. This is maybe a third or fourth line agent for now. Maybe it will move up for the heart failure population, which is a soluble guanylate cyclase stimulator. So the brand name is Vercuvo, which increases the production, and what it does is increase the production of CGMP, cyclic guanosine monophosphate. And as you can see, it has a number of effects on the heart, blood vessels, and kidney. This is specifically, while we think of it in this category as a blood pressure lowering agent, it is specifically for the heart failure population, those with an ejection fraction less than 45% and have an established diagnosis, obviously, and specifically for those who have had a hospitalization. These are the individuals that are where it's indicated to use this to prevent recurrent hospitalization. Excuse me. I want to talk a little bit about selective MRAs. So obviously we know about spironolactone and eplerenone, but the discussion would also should also center on finerenone, which is a novel agent that we think is a little bit more selective for aldosterone inhibition and has been found to be helpful in the CKD population, particularly when it's associated with diabetes. And we can see how finerenone's inhibition of aldosterone can produce a number of important effects via minimizing reactive oxygen species that are pro-inflammatory and reduce nitric oxide production and availability. Finally, just within this category, I want to talk about selective aldosterone synthase inhibition, a new category when it comes to blood pressure lowering. And specifically, there is a medication that has been looked at and has become popular, or at least in public consciousness within the past year, called baxdrostat. And this was looked at in a trial called Brighton, where it did quite well, but a follow-up trial called Halo showed that maybe it didn't significantly reduce blood pressure much more than placebo, although a criticism of the trial was that there may have been some non-adherence in the treatment arm. Now, with all that said, you might ask, you know, why is inhibiting aldosterone such a big deal? Why haven't we done this in the past? But it turns out that in order to selectively inhibit aldosterone, it's actually quite challenging, because the problem is that you can see, because of common precursors, it's very easy to inhibit cortisol in the process. So in this quest for a discovery of a drug that actually reduces aldosterone, basically all the other candidates were reducing steroids and cortisol, which did not sit well with people and cause a lot of side effects. So this medication finally is a targeted, uses a targeted pathway to inhibit aldosterone, and was found to be quite effective. So we'll see as time goes on how much this really picks up in terms of use, and if it's able to make it into final phase trials and move on to be approved. So switching gears, let's talk about procedural approaches, specifically renal denervation. So renal denervation is a catheter-based technique that probably most of you know about at this time to reduce blood pressure by reducing sympathetic input to the kidneys. And you may have heard about this some years back because early studies showed promise, but then subsequent research was a little bit lukewarm about its efficacy, the outcomes, variable patient responses. But the truth is that a lot of it is making a comeback. And part of this is that we have improved techniques and technology. We have more rigorous clinical trials that mainly center on better patient selection, improved protocols, better follow-up, and the population of patients that could be eligible has been expanded. And specifically, the RADIANT studies, which has been several trials that have been published in the last few years, have shown that this approach is in fact feasible and is effective. Just want to talk a little bit about RADIANT because it is a trial that we're running at the Pacific Heart Institute as a site and using a specific catheter-based technology from Recor Medical. But in brief, without getting too in-depth about the procedural specifics, the background behind renal denervation is that basically you have efferent nerve activation and afferent nerve activation that is a reason as to why blood pressure remains elevated. It's this chronic sympathetic outflow or promotion that is a part of the reason that people have refractory hypertension, if not one of the major, if not one the only reason, I should say. And so what we're looking at is a catheter-based strategy to interrupt this renal nerve traffic, so to say, to treat hypertension. And the way that this specific catheter works from Rigved Medical is called the Paradise Ultrasound Renal Denervation System, is that it essentially ablates the renal nerves on the outside of the artery while still protecting the renal artery from the inside, or at least that's the way that they pitch it from a marketing perspective. The actual procedure itself is actually straightforward for us from a cardiovascular perspective, because gaining access to the renal arteries is not particularly difficult from a femoral approach. The procedure time is actually quite short. The ablation only takes a few seconds, and there's only 2 to 3 ablations delivered to the main renal artery, so we don't even need to go into branches. And then you can see some of the catheter specifics there. But in brief, in the RADIANT trials, we saw a mean reduction in daytime ambulatory blood pressure, systolic blood pressure, of about 8 points compared to 2 points in the sham arm. So essentially, that's a statistically significant and we would say clinically relevant between group difference of about 6 millimeters of mercury with no major adverse events observed. And again, we are enrolling patients for this specific study. So if you have patients that have poorly controlled hypertension on just 2 medications, they may potentially be eligible. And yes, there is more criteria that they need to, in order for them to be eligible for the study, but we're happy to sort through those if you are able to send patients our way. Personalized treatment for hypertension. Now, we know that hypertension is influenced by genetic and environmental factors. So briefly, I want to talk about pharmacogenomics, which is how genetic variation impacts an individual's response to medication. So when we talk about optimizing management for these conditions like hypertension and hyperlipidemia, the future of medicine will take into account these genetic variations because this can affect drug metabolism, efficacy, and side effects. And in a sense, we already practice pharmacogenomics unknowingly in that we try a medication to see how it might work for somebody and we sort of hope for the best. And if it doesn't work, we think about changing the dose, changing the medication. We're just doing it a little blindly. So what pharmacogenomics or the promise of it is that we can do that with a little bit more guidance. And really that's the crux of the whole thing, allowing drug response prediction and tailored treatment. The benefits of personalized treatment using pharmacogenomics to guide it is enhanced drug selection, improved drug efficacy, and hopefully reduced adverse effects. And so some variants right now that are being looked at, although obviously we're not using in clinical practice or testing for specifically right at the moment, include some CYP enzyme variants, also ADRB1 gene variants, which can affect the response to beta blockers, and NPPA gene variants that can, which is associated with response to diuretics. So these are some things coming down the pipeline that we may potentially be testing for. And once we gain more data in terms of the actual specifics in terms of how people are affected, may be helpful in crafting a more personalized treatment strategy. But the future right now for personalized treatment is really as follows. Basically, genetic testing is required. So that's something where it would have to become normalized. We'd have to integrate that data into the EHR to make informed treatment decisions. And obviously, we need to educate patients about the importance of this so that they are interested and want to take charge of their own health. So ongoing research in this field right now includes looking at additional genetic markers and then using that to refine treatment guidelines, and then integrating this pharmacogenomic information with other patient with other patient-specific factors to really usher in an era of personalized medicine. So similarly, in the last 10 or so minutes, I just want to talk a bit about hyperlipidemia and follow a similar structure, looking at combo therapies, novel drugs, and then the era of personalized treatment. And we'll wrap up from there. But with cholesterol lowering, the primary goal still to this day in this era is to achieve target lipid levels, but particularly LDL-C, which is the major contributor to atherosclerosis and cardiovascular disease. And yes, there are other lipoproteins that are implicated, but clinically speaking, this is the most actionable, which is why we spend the most time discussing it. With combination therapy, statin-based combinations are the cornerstone of hyperlipidemia treatment. Everyone knows this, and we know that statins primarily lower LDL-C. But combination therapy has traditionally, and when I say traditionally, probably in the last 10 to 15 years, involved using ezetimibe, which inhibits cholesterol absorption from the small intestine, leading to additional LDL-C reduction when used in combination with a statin. There was a trial called the IMPROVE-IT trial that looked at using ezetimibe with simvastatin in a post-MI population that did show that there was an additional incremental benefit. And we use this often, or we cite this often as a reason as to why we like ezetimibe, but there have been other studies that have shown improvements in LDL-C and cardiovascular events with use of ezetimibe with a statin. And then of course, PCSK9 inhibitors, which some may still consider as a new kid on the block. They're becoming quite commonplace. It's almost been 10 years since they've been approved and have been used in clinical practice, which sounds pretty crazy from my perspective. Time has flown. But these drugs work by blocking PCSK9, and we'll go into the mechanistic details briefly, but they have essentially become the next line of therapy after statins for most individuals, especially those who have had cardiovascular events. The whole idea behind this combination therapy is really an individualized approach. And the main reason I mention this is because a lot of people have side effects from statins, or at least perceived to have them. And so therapy should really be tailored to the individual. And in hyperlipidemia, this is more important than ever because of the lack of tolerability of statins for many individuals. So the individual patient characteristics, their lipid profile, their risk profile, their comorbidities, and specifically medication tolerability should be looked at in this individualized approach. And of course, when we're combining therapies, we want to look at the safety, but specifically if you're looking for something clinically, particularly liver function tests, especially with the addition of ezetimibe and statin together, would be something that we would be particularly interested in looking at. But generally, this combination is quite well tolerated. So these novel therapies, again, PCSK9 inhibitors, the two on the market are Praluent and Repatha. These inhibit PCSK9 to allow an increase in the number of LDL receptors on the hepatic cell surface that allows LDL-C to be removed from the bloodstream. There's the small interfering RNA. Some of you may not have heard of these agents. There's one on the market called inclisiran, which became commercially available at the beginning of 2022. It's known as Leqvio. And essentially, this is an interfering RNA that inhibits the expression of the PCSK9 gene. So it works one step up from a PCSK9 inhibitor to inhibit the production of this protein and therefore, again, increase the number of available LDL receptors to clear LDL from the bloodstream. Then there are also ATP citrate lyase inhibitors, ACL inhibitors, one of which is called bempedoic acid. The trade name is Nexletol. This works to block ACL, reducing the production of cholesterol and lowering LDL-C levels. To keep it simple, this works a couple steps up from where the statin works, an HMGA-CoA reductase inhibitor. And this schematic, even though it's a little busy, kind of brings a lot of this together. You'll see some other agents there that we're not discussing today that are primarily used for homozygous hypercholesterolemia, familial homozygous hypercholesterolemia, which is a rare disease. But you can see where PCSK9 inhibitors fit in there on the lower left, inclisiran, which is this interfering RNA, and then of course statins and bempedoic acid. And you can see they work on the same pathway in the liver. And then ezetimibe there on the right side, which is independent of the liver working in the small intestine. What are some other novel therapies? So omega-3 fatty acids, there's frequent discussion in the cardiovascular community and probably in the neurology community as well about the role of these. It seems as though the neurology community is a little more pro omega-3 than we are. Not that we're against it, but the time and again, the evidence has been a little bit neutral from a cardiovascular perspective, with the exception of one specific agent called icosapent ethyl, which is a high dose EPA fish oil, which in a clinical trial did show anti-inflammatory effects that reduce cardiovascular risk, but in a very specific population. It was patients who have already had events or were at high risk. The problem with Vascepa, at least initially, is that it's quite expensive. So a lot of patients really weren't too excited about it. And beyond that, there is an increased risk of atrial fibrillation for people taking the medications. So we've been a little bit, or the community has been a little bit lukewarm, at least, or many, I would say, cardiologists have been lukewarm in terms of prescribing these routinely. Other things, NO-derived compounds have been looked at to regulate the biosynthesis of PCSK9 inhibitors. This is sort of interesting because we think of nitric oxide usually in the context of vasodilation and blood vessel health, but there have been compounds that have been derived from NO that can regulate cholesterol. So a specific compound has been shown to be effective in mice in preliminary studies. So obviously that would need to be studied in the human population. There is CRISPR gene editing. So for those who are fans of gene editing and who are interested in this specific territory, Verve Therapeutics has created an oral medication that essentially edits the PCSK9 gene. It's extremely novel, I believe, first oral gene editing therapy, and is being studied. The hope here is that it would permanently cure hypercholesterolemia, which is a tall task, but you know, may potentially be down the pipeline if it looks like it works. So something to keep an eye out on. And then lipoprotein A lowering. I won't go into too much depth about lipoprotein A today, but it is a lipoprotein that has been associated with significant atherosclerotic risk and aortic stenosis as well. That is an emerging risk factor, something that we sort of knew about before, but now as we've learned more, we realize how bad it is. There are two classes of medications to lower LPA that are being studied now, with pelacarsen being an important one from the Horizon study. And we are expected to have outcomes from these trials sometime over the next several years. Briefly, personalized treatment for lipid lowering, talking about pharmacogenomics, the key variants to know about in hyperlipidemia. Of course, if you have a variation in the PCSK9 gene, this might impact the efficacy of PCSK9 inhibitors. And there are a couple other genes here that can affect the response to statins, including the risk of muscle-related side effects. So it would be great if we could test somebody to find out if they're likely to have muscle-related side effects so that we either minimize or avoid statins in that population, given that we have a number of other therapies available now in the armamentarium. And then, of course, there is the APO gene variants, not to be confused with APOE4, but similar on a molecular level. But it turns out that variants in the APOE gene can influence response to lipid-lowering therapies and the risk for cardiovascular events. So in terms of these applications, the applications of pharmacogenomics and hyperlipidemia, obviously, we want to identify the genetic variants. We want to use this to find the most appropriate lipid-lowering therapies, and to reduce side effects and enhance patient outcomes. So in conclusion, to wrap up here, and I'm happy to do Q&A, lots of great stuff to discuss. Both cardiovascular and neurologic conditions share many common risk factors and mechanisms. Cognitive impairment specifically associated with cardiovascular disease includes vascular cognitive impairment, Alzheimer's disease, and dementia. So it's important to think about these when we're thinking about cardiovascular risk factors and the overlap between cardiovascular disease and brain health. Lifestyle interventions can modify cardiovascular risk factors. Let's not forget about it. If it's done properly, it can make a huge impact and therefore can also improve brain health. And of course, we have our pharmacologic interventions and device interventions, such as therapies for blood pressure and cholesterol that can reduce the risk of cardiovascular disease and therefore potentially improve neurologic function or at least maintain it. And of course, this crowd knows ongoing research is key for us to figure out these relationships and to better inform prevention and treatment strategies. So I just wanted to flash my socials here, like a lot of other speakers do. Speak a lot about prevention as well as other cardiovascular topics on my socials. They are sort of somewhat organized by degree of professionality, I suppose. But for the most part, I try to stay on target and keep it pretty professional and try to keep people entertained in the process. So feel free to look me up, either RVTMD or RVT.MD, depending on the platform. And just want to thank you for your attention and really appreciate the opportunity.
Rigved, that was fantastic. That was perfect, actually. And you got me amped as well here.
Absolutely.
This is just a topic of exploding interest. And even just from graduating from training, you know, 6-7 years ago, I was blown away by all of the new medications, all the new therapies that is just are going to continue to help both fields.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So I have a few questions, but I think let's start with the audience first.
Sure.
The Dr. Dougal, one of our wonderful ophthalmologists recently retired, is asking, are you saying that alcohol, red meat, tropical oils, full fat dairy should be avoided altogether or not just reduced?
Yeah, that's a tough one. You know, I always tell people when it comes to prevention, this is always a challenging topic because the easy part is actually identifying disease and then treating it, right? So what most of us do, it's like, hey, from in our perspective, I have a heart attack in front of me, NSTEMI, STEMI, whatever it is. I know exactly what I need to do to treat it to get the most effective outcome. Now, when it comes to prevention, there's a lot of guesswork because the answer is probably not the same for every individual. In theory, it would be nice to eliminate those things completely. And maybe there is a subset of people who really need to do that because their risk factors are really high or they have a family history or they have genetic influences. But I think by and large, the goal is not to be punitive. You know, these are more just guidelines, right? Just, you know, things that people can hang their hat on. I don't think it needs to be avoided completely. In fact, you know, I would say that from a quality of life perspective, it's not unreasonable to incorporate these things in the diet. I think the idea is to try to minimize these as much as possible because all the evidence points to the fact that they're not particularly helpful in terms of heart health. So I think to answer that, I think the answer is different for everybody. Certainly, I don't think there's a population that would benefit from having that as their primary dietary source. You know, I think minimization is probably the key, knowing that in reality, there's going to be very few people who are going to be able to eliminate them altogether.
That's what some of these studies, you know more about the China study than I do. And it's just, you know, saying even a small amount, it kind of, I feel like it confuses the message and scares people.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, I think that's a great point. You know, I think we often are too quick to chastise patients. And, you know, let's think about it. I mean, we have to think about ourselves too. Like, are we doing all these things ourselves, right? Like, that's what we preach. So I think it's better to give practical advice and, you know, not be punitive when we talk about these things with patients.
You know, to carry on that point, and this is more of a personal interest point, thing for me, the plant-based meats, you know, 3-4 years ago was all the fad, you know, in regards to taking people off of these quote unquote bad things. And it seems to have hit a snag here from, I guess, a processed food perspective. Mm-hmm. Is that something you're dealing with in terms of discussions with patients recently?
And you're talking about like the Beyond Meats and
the Beyond Meats, the Impossibles and all of them, you know, everybody tried to get into that game recently and they seem to be dealing with some controversy currently.
Right. You know, I think the idea and what people should remember with the meat substitutes is that the initial idea behind them was to really, and to make them popular was to really mimic the taste of meat, right? Is to the texture, the taste, and to sort of make it indistinguishable as an option for those who, for a variety of reasons, probably didn't want to consume animal products. And in that process, there are some, I guess, heart healthy components of, you know, this plant-based sort of meat, but there are a lot of other additives as well that we don't really quite know about. And so I think that time will tell to sort of for us to know really where things stand in terms of consuming plant-based, you know, meat regularly. For now, my advice for people, especially if they enjoy it, this includes myself, I actually try to mix it up. So I'll do a little bit of both. Just to try to minimize my animal protein sources, but still have some degree of plant-based sources. But I am aware that, you know, we can't just eat the plant-based protein, or I should rephrase, really like Beyond Meat or like the meat substitutes, probably a better way to put it.
Yeah.
We can't just eat them with reckless abandon. Like, you know, there's still probably a lot to be learned there.
So what about mental stress? Isn't that a CV risk factor?
It's kind of funny that somebody mentioned that because there's actually a recent study. And in fact, you might see it flash across your screens over the last day or so, and actually contributed to an article about it, that mental health conditions in patients who are, or people, I should say, in their 20 to 40 range, significantly increase the risk of cardiovascular disease independent of other risk factors. And probably the mechanisms need to be understood. An important caveat to that study, though, was that they didn't look at medication patterns. So it's possible that some of the adverse effects of psychotropic medications might contribute to some of this metabolic dysfunction as well. But yes, in general, mental stress can be a big risk factor for cardiovascular disease. The primary etiology we think there, especially for individuals of any age, but particularly as people get older, is that the sympathetic nervous system dysfunction, autonomic nervous system dysfunction can really impact blood vessel health as we discussed, you know, when we talked about mechanisms. So definitely there is a link there. It's not fake when people say, hey, I was, you know, really angry and I had chest pain. You know, we really take that seriously, like when we hear that in the clinic, because, you know, stuff tells us that, you know, there really could be a true pathophysiologic link there.
We have that on the neurosurgery side from, you know, we get a lot of intracranial hemorrhages, subarachnoid hemorrhages, aneurysm ruptures that seem to be precipitated by one of these hyper-emotional events.
Ooh, absolutely.
Do you recommend a one-time screening for lipo? Oh, that's a great question from Dr. Nelson. Do you recommend a one-time screening of lipoprotein A to assess risk for cardiovascular risk beyond just the lipid panel? Such a tough question, but very interesting.
Yeah, this is a great question. It's an evolving science. Right now, I fall in line with a lot of cardiologists, which is that we should do a one-time screening of lipoprotein A. In reality, because of its emergence, it's probably getting checked even more than once, especially if patients have cardiologists. But yes, we would say one time. The reason we say one time, you may ask why one time and not multiple times, is that lipoprotein A is 85 to 90% genetically mediated. So there's very little that you could do to influence the level, although certain medications can either increase or reduce it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the problem with lipoprotein A is that even though there are medicines that reduce levels, quote unquote, they're not reducing the level enough to cause a cardiovascular benefit. And this is the problem. So some people say, well, what about niacin? You know, niacin helps reduce LPA. Why aren't we using it? And the reason is because we just don't have any evidence that it's lowering it enough to actually make an impact. And so this is where some of these newer dedicated lipoprotein A reducing agents are going to come onto the scene, which can reduce LPA 70 to 80%, I believe, you know, as a ballpark figure. And we are hoping, and at least the preliminary data suggests that they will help improve the cardiovascular event rates. Now, you might say, okay, well, fine, but that's not here yet. What do I do if I have an elevated LPA? And the general consensus based on guidelines is that if it's present, we focus on the things that we can improve. And so really that the focus still becomes LDL-C lowering. And in fact, from our perspective, we're more aggressive about LDL-C lowering when people have an elevated LPA to try to offset it, so to say.
For example, are you going down from 100 to 70, something of that sort for LDL levels, or is it way more complicated than that?
Yeah, it's a little bit more complex because this is where like overall cardiovascular risk, you know,
sure.
But I think as a general measure, if people are looking for numeric guidance, then actually that sounds pretty reasonable. We would say, you know, getting to at least 70 is probably appropriate, as 70 was our original cutoff. for LDL for individuals who've had a history of cardiovascular events. So we think that for a primary prevention population, that should be fairly reasonable.
Hmm. From Dr. Yazdi, can a patient continue calcium channel blockers despite swelling of the legs?
Yeah, it's a great question. Technically speaking, they can. There's nothing specifically pathophysiologically that's sort of wrong with the cardiovascular system when that happens. I think some people might misinterpret it to think that maybe they have a reduced ejection fraction or somehow the function of their heart was impacted. So technically speaking, you can continue it, but it is true that many patients do find it bothersome. So oftentimes either reducing the dose or picking a different agent is probably better. And then of course, you know, we don't want to sort of impose, you know, chronic venous stasis and chronic lower extremity edema for a variety of reasons. Even if it ends up just being cosmetic, just because of the hemosiderin deposition, you know, people really find it bothersome. Not to mention it can affect mobility and just generally be painful, actually. So people can continue it, but oftentimes if it's bothersome enough, we'll just switch them off of it.
Dr. Nelson also asked for renal denervation study. What classes of antihypertensives are needed for inclusion? And should there already be screening for the renin-aldosterone prior to consideration?
I don't think they need to be screened for renin-aldosterone prior to consideration. In terms of the inclusion antihypertensive medications, I actually think it can be any two agents, as far as I understand. I'd have to go back and look at the protocol to see if it includes like a MRA, a mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist. The reason I sort of purposefully kept it broad is that like we're happy to screen. Essentially, like if you have it, someone who you think might fit the bill, we're happy to get our research coordinators on it and see if they might fit the criteria.
We have several patients from the neuroscience realm. I had like three patients from clinic yesterday, including young patients with just severe recalcitrant hypertension, you know, four agents who are presenting in their 20s with intracranial hemorrhages. And, you know, so far the secondary screen has been negative. I don't know, it must have been a bad run yesterday, but yeah. Some people I need to send your way.
Absolutely.
Very interesting. The Dr. Yazdi asked, what is the effect of coenzyme Q10 and muscle pain due to statins?
Yeah, it's a great question. So right now, CoQ10 is being investigated as an agent to be potentially helpful in a number of different conditions. Some people have touted it for blood pressure lowering, quote unquote, overall cardiovascular health, which I find kind of interesting, but CoQ10 has sort of, you know, taken off as the supplement that people generally find to be heart healthy. And some of that is still being elucidated, especially in the heart failure population, to see if it may have a beneficial effect. And I believe there are clinical trials being run on it for that reason. But the one place that we do often use it clinically, and I would actually almost venture to say it's probably the only time we really recommend a supplement in cardiology, is for statin-related myalgias. It seems to really get the job done for a number of people, and we can go to fairly reasonable doses, 200, 300, up to 600 milligrams of CoQ10, and it seems to really work. So oftentimes, if muscle pains that people will have from statins are not particularly severe, maybe they're mild and people are kind of on the fence about whether they want to continue at a specific dose or with a statin, I'll say, okay, well, let's try CoQ10 and let's try to ramp up the dose and let's just see if it makes a difference. And if it really does put you in a place where you're feeling much better and this is truly in your heart, not bothersome to you, then this would be a great strategy. But if it's not enough, then, you know, oftentimes we'll look at alternatives. But yes, CoQ10 we are using frequently to help mitigate these side effects.
Great. Dr. Kalt just mentions amazing overview. Thank you.
Sure thing.
Agreed. Dr. Yasharel mentions, thank you. Great presentation. Would Farsiga help with coronary artery disease as well?
It's a great question. So Farsiga can help in a variety of different ways. In terms of coronary artery disease specifically, we don't have an indication for Farsiga for that specific reason. However, it is useful and has been approved for those with multiple cardiovascular risk factors in the setting of diabetes. So we're not quite there, and we haven't really gotten an indication for CAD in of itself. It's probably most helpful right now in the heart failure population, whether it's a preserved ejection fraction or reduced ejection fraction.
Perfect. And then Dr. Brocanthi, one of our wonderful repeat guests, asks, what is the role of lipoprotein A levels?
Yeah, so just to kind of further that discussion, you know, essentially lipoprotein A is a molecule that is sort of, you know, attached to LDL, and people have to varying levels. And what we found is that it's specifically atherogenic and can increase the risk of cardiovascular disease, including coronary disease. But there seems to be a link even with aortic stenosis, which is a big one, because until now, we haven't really had too much by way of potential treatments for aortic stenosis. I think the hope is that treating LPA is going to reduce cardiovascular events and issues. And if we could see this as a potential preventative treatment for something like aortic stenosis, that would be a huge win. So there's more to come on the LPA story. For now, I think the important thing is to check it, because we know that if it's elevated, it is going to lend to a worsened prognosis. So, you know, for now, at least we try to modify what we can.
I have a question for you. In terms of neurosurgical diseases, et cetera, we have a very, relatively speaking, we have a small group of patients, you know, stroke, third biggest cause of death in America. But outside of stroke, the number of neurologic diseases, the absolute number is quite small. So it makes reaching the high levels of trial enrollment, like the cardiology trials, very, very difficult. Mm-hmm. So we are having this issue, particularly in neuro-oncology, in terms of deciding best treatments. During this era of personalized medicine, you know, trial formation and trial design has become enormously more complex and challenging.
Absolutely.
How are you guys dealing with that? Or what are the kind of challenges you guys are noting from that standpoint?
Yeah, well, you know, I have to admit, like, I would say that, you know, from our standpoint, it's been a little bit more straightforward, just because, you know, we just have a huge population that we mm-hmm. can sort of look at. And yes, it is true that I think as time has gone on, we've become sort of more open to the fact that you don't need to run a randomized control trial for everything, right? Because it's a little impractical, and you need the funding, and you sort of need the right patient population. You got to enroll people in a certain amount of time. So it may not always be necessary, but I think this is where like advanced statistical methods can really make a big difference. Certainly on the remote monitoring side, you know, I always point to the Apple Heart Study as a very classic example of a modern clinical trial where the inclusion was all virtual and remote. And if you had a device and you were over 18, for the most part, you could get into the study. And the whole thing was sort of conducted remotely through remote sites. And I think that's sort of like the future of research, is that we need to find a way to pool patients and individuals in a more, I guess, non-traditional fashion in order to get the type of statistical power that we would want to see.
Wonderful. Yeah. Wonderful. We are basically, I think, from a neurosurgical space, following your lead, you know, just because data-wise, big trial-wise, you guys have led the way, you know, with those large center studies.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely.
Let me make sure Dr. Selwyn says, great presentation. And I'm just going to review the chat box to make sure there weren't any additional questions. If anybody wants to say anything, or please feel free to raise your hand as well, and we can raise you up to panelist if you wanted to bring up anything that may be too hard to type. Rigved, very, very thankful you were able to join us today. I've been looking forward to this for a while. That was fantastic. I very much appreciate your expertise here. I think you're a growing star in the field, and I'm glad you're sort of with us here in Providence. So thank you very much.
Thank you for the kind words, and I really appreciate you thinking of me for this presentation. Definitely other things to discuss too. So, you know, I find these to be very lively, very helpful to have this cross-disciplinary approach, and really appreciate the stuff that you're doing in the space as well. And the platform that you built here. So we're, you know, excited to move forward together.
Yeah, there's a lot that's going to be happening here. So I'd love for you to come back in a couple of years you know, with an update on a lot of these things, maybe more of the lipoprotein A study and then the Radiance trial as well. Things yes. like that, that'd be great.
Absolutely. Happy to chat about that or anything else.
And for everybody in the audience to know, Dr. Tadwalkar has agreed to, you know, share the information, and we will be posting the grand rounds on the Pacific Neuroscience Institute website, which has the repository of all the neuroscience grand rounds for, I think, since sometime in 2021. So you always have a reference to refer back to. Thank you all for joining us again. Please have a happy and safe month. Next month, we are going to have another very special talk by Dr. Gustavo Perdia, who is the principal investigator in the world's first positive study for surgical treatment of intracranial hemorrhages, the ENRICH trial, which recently presented its results of the landmark study at our American Association of Neurological Surgeons meeting a couple of weeks ago here in Los Angeles. You're not going to want to miss that. And if you have any requests for different topics that you want to see covered, please feel free to reach out and we will make sure we get the best speaker for that topic. Thank you, everybody, and have a good day. Take care.
Thanks.